Oh my God. Can you just leave me for a moment, please? I will get what I can, but there's a huge change in the running order here.
Stand by VT20.
Stand by TX. A, B, C, and D in that order from 5 seconds.
9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
This is BBC News at 100. For a century, we have been bringing you the biggest news stories from here and around the world as our journalists witness some of the most historic moments. From Richard Dimbleby, the BBC's first war reporter, who broadcast from RAF fighter planes during World War II.
The bombers of the main force are now streaming in above and below us. As we drive steadily over Cologne in a dead level straight line, the German flak is winking and flashing.
To Kate Adie on the scene as Chinese troops fired on protesters in Tiananmen Square.
After hours of shooting and facing a line of troops, the crowd is still here. They're shouting, "Stop the killing and down with the government."
And who can forget Michael Burke's reports from Africa as he revealed the full scale of the famine in Ethiopia.
Dawn, and as the sun breaks through the piercing chill of night on the plain outside Corum, it lights up a biblical famine.
His reports were a watershed moment that led to this. Bob Geldof's Live Aid concerts raised tens of millions in the wake of the BBC's journalism. And when COVID swept the globe and lockdowns took hold, our correspondents were on the front line, as always.
The staff here are dealing with the biggest challenge ever faced by the NHS. They can save many of the patients, but sadly, not all of them.
Hello and welcome to BBC News as we mark our 100th birthday, and what a century it has been. Technology has revolutionised the way we bring the news to you, but at the heart of it all, our job remains the same, and that is to bring you the news that matters when it happens. So let's go back to the very beginning, when BBC News was born and radio ruled the airwaves.
2LO Marconi House, London calling.
London calling.
When the BBC started in 1922, the news was broadcast through only one medium, the wireless.
London calling. Here is the news.
Then radio bulletins were read by men.
Well, since then, the voices and faces of newsreaders have changed. During the Second World War, the BBC played a pivotal role in reporting the news, both good and bad. Richard Dimbleby was a familiar and trusted voice for millions of people. Here's his radio report from 1945 after entering the Belsen concentration camp with British forces. Just imagine what it was like hearing this at home.
I passed through the barrier and found myself in the world of a nightmare. Dead bodies, some of them in decay, lay strewn about the road and along the rutted tracks. Inside the huts, it was even worse. I've seen many terrible sights in the last 5 years, but nothing approaching the dreadful interior of this hut at Belsen.
Today is Victory in Europe Day.
Richard Dimbleby was also the voice of the nation as the war ended.
Mr. Churchill was coming out again. Now listen, the band is playing Land of Hope and Glory, and the crowd is singing, and this suddenly has become a very moving moment. Will you listen, please?
Here is the news.
In the 1950s, we saw the first regular television news bulletins.
After Manchester United's air crash at Munich this afternoon.
And amid slow fair flurries, when this BEA Elizabethan, which had been chartered by Manchester United,
these blurry black and white pictures following the 1958 Munich air disaster, in which 8 Manchester United players were among 23 who died, show just how quickly moving pictures could be broadcast.
Film stories from abroad also arrive here from the BBC's camera crews overseas.
We are trusted around the world.
Standing on top of the Berlin Wall, which for years has been the most potent symbol of the division of Europe.
Mr. Mandela, James Robbins, BBC News from London. Can you describe your emotions as you came out of the prison?
I was completely overwhelmed.
Not always welcome.
Thank you very much, Mr. President.
Where are you from?
BBC.
Okay. Here's another beauty.
But they're at critical moments.
After hours of trying to make their way in, they've finally done it. Protesters have pushed their way through the gates of the Prime Minister's office and now everywhere.
I've worked for the BBC for over half the time it's existed, and I've spent almost all my career covering international news. This is Kyiv in Ukraine. The job can be pretty dangerous. Far too many friends and colleagues have been killed or injured in the course of their work. But we perform a crucial role, giving an impartial account of what's going on and why it matters to you at home. In 2003, a convoy I was travelling with in northern Iraq was bombed by mistake by an American warplane. 18 people, including our translator, were killed. You may find this and some of the other reports upsetting.
We reached a crossroads. Then, out of the blue, the American plane attacked.
Sky right beside him.
You're right.
The ammunition and rockets in the wrecked cars began exploding. The bomb had landed only 10 yards away from us. I even saw it fall.
For decades, we've had teams on the ground reporting conflict. The Vietnam War.
This is a very humiliating day for the South Vietnamese Army. And we're hoping that this is the very last battle outside Saigon.
Battles between India and Pakistan.
Well, we haven't been here for more than 7 or 8 minutes at this airfield, and in that time there have been 3 strikes. This is the third one coming over now. There's the big guns firing. And there's a saber just gone overhead.
With British forces in the South Atlantic.
Argentina has invaded the Falklands.
I'm not allowed to say how many planes joined the raid, but I counted them all out, and I counted them all back.
America under attack.
Steve, I understand that you were in the World Trade Center when it was struck.
I was on the ground floor of the building. There was a huge bang in the yard which separates the two huge towers which are the World Trade Center. Seconds later, there were 2 or 3 similar huge explosions, and the building literally shook.
And a tragedy abroad which moved many at home.
An early morning car crash in a Paris underpass ended a life with more than its share of pain and courage, warmth and compassion.
In 2022 in Europe.
We're live in Ukraine as Russia invades in a major military assault by land, sea and air.
Civilians are supposed to be protected by the laws of war. Russian shells were very close. Stopping was not an option. I'm okay, she said. Keep going.
A fair amount of incoming fire coming into this now. Artillery fire, there are loads of civilians around.
Counting the cost of human conflict.
So the women and children are being pulled from the crowd on the stairs now so that they can board the train. The police, again, are outnumbered, but they are doing their best. I've seen them go down there into the crowds and try and calm people. But it's very, very difficult given the volatility of the situation.
And the impact on the most vulnerable.
5-year-old Malik is slowly getting used to walking. She lost her left leg when her home in Syria was bombed last year.
Kilo, bye.
Bye.
How difficult is it for you as a mum in this situation?
It is difficult. Our place and our caravan, they are not fit for living in.
The dispossessed of eastern Congo.
The scene here now is absolutely chaotic.
Children are being trampled in the rush as people push their way through the gates.
We saw youngsters in distress and helped drag them to safety. Another terrifying moment for children already traumatized by conflict.
Two rows of concrete blocks are now home for 38 families. Crude metal roofs don't keep winter snows out, and they don't keep anyone warm.
The children are everywhere, and you see them there. Their hands are freezing, and their teeth are chattering. They're so cold.
We all live in an age of non-stop news, with information literally at your fingertip. And we have news teams right across the UK, chasing stories, checking facts, reporting accurately and fairly. And I have a vague memory of being about 5 or 6 years old and seeing television reports of a real disaster that had happened in a village not far from where I lived.
It's now feared that nearly 200 lives were lost when the coal tip at Abervan near Merthyr Tydfil slid forward today. It engulfed an infant school and a row of houses.
And still it goes on, the never-ending search for the bodies of the men, women and children who are buried down here beneath the slurry and sludge. And it's attracted rescuers from, well, all over Wales, in fact from England as well. They're streaming across the Severn Bridge from Bristol offering their services. And Bill, if I can ask you to come in for a moment. I know you've just this moment come up from what looks like Dante's Inferno down there. What, in fact, is it like?
I think it's absolute hell because men are working knee-deep in liquid slurry, trying to dig out the kids from the school.
Where did you first hear about the tragedy?
I heard BBC News.
In Northern Ireland, we covered the worst days of the Troubles.
This is the reality of Belfast today. Bombs in the city centre, so much disruption, so many explosions. From time to time, you forget that it's become part of everyday life.
And its hopes for a brighter future.
An historic agreement for peace in Northern Ireland has been reached within the past few minutes. We can see pictures now from Stormont, where the leaders of the 8 parties which have been involved in the talks, together with the Prime Ministers of the United Kingdom and the Republic of Ireland, are announcing details of an agreement which is intended to end nearly 30 years of conflict and which have cost more than 3,000 lives.
Agreement. The impossible was done late this afternoon, but done it was, to the delight of the Prime Ministers, their sad remembrance of the injured and the dead, their realistic hopes for the children's future.
The Prime Minister announces the toughest restrictions on our way of life in living memory. From tonight, you can only leave your home for very specific reasons.
We kept audiences up to date as the virus spread.
Coughing can project small droplets up to 6 metres.
The anguish of thousands who lost loved ones. Families separated by the pandemic.
No, you can't touch my hand.
This is the first time Julie Bennett has seen her father in 4 weeks.
Heartbreaking, heartbreaking.
Those supporting the work of the NHS. Those working for it.
Somebody have to be a doctor, one have to be a nurse, and somebody have to be a domestic. So I'm proud of what I am.
Because all together, you're helping to save lives.
We have all of us come together and then we save more lives.
And the first signs of hope.
Margaret, aged 90, was the very first patient to receive the newly approved coronavirus vaccine.
And what do you say to those who might be having second thoughts about having this vaccine?
Well, it's the best thing that's ever happened.
Balcony doors are open. BBC News has brought the nation together for the major royal occasions.
Lots of shouts from the crowd here.
The weddings.
And that's the reward.
The jubilees. And the royal visits.
Today, a unique moment with a very special royal guest.
It is a great pleasure to visit the BBC today. I remember first coming to Broadcasting House with my father, the King, and my mother and sister shortly before the war. I came again with the Duke of Edinburgh just before the coronation in 1953. I was struck then, as I am now, by the sheer pace of change which has transformed your industry over the past 60 years. Years during which broadcasting has enriched our lives in so many ways.
And the saddest of times. This is BBC News from London. A few moments ago, Buckingham Palace announced the death of Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II.
Good morning. Welcome to BBC Breakfast. We're at Westminster Abbey on an historic day.
On the coffin, a card handwritten by the King in loving and devoted memory, Charles R.
From Lloyd George to Liz Truss, the BBC's political reporters have stood here trying to record everything that happened behind that famous door. The choices made by prime ministers that affect us all, even life or death, and many decisions that made history.
Sir Winston Churchill has resigned from the position of prime minister.
He made the radio broadcast his own, but Winston Churchill was not a fan of TV.
Mr. Harold Wilson is speeding towards London by train. We think we may be able to contact him by radio telephone. We're going to try.
And Mr. Wilson?
Others soon saw the opportunity.
May I tell you the result of the Labour gain this morning at Brighton Kempton?
Hello, I seem to have lost you.
Thank you, tunnel.
The BBC, Mrs. Thatcher.
It's crafted their sound bites.
Where there is doubt, may we bring faith. And where there is despair, may we bring hope.
What there are hundreds of members of the media who swarm around the Prime Minister.
Had fun at our expense.
And the idea from the Conservatives' point of view is to get the best possible experience.
Mrs. Thatcher, could I ask you to comment?
Their cameras captured history.
It's here, this is the microphone.
I'm naturally very pleased that I got more.
We saw power transferred.
The Scottish Parliament adjourned on the 25th day of March in the year 1707 is hereby reconvened.
So, Wales, after all that, has voted yes.
And it is a very good morning in Wales. Yeah.
Good morning from Brian Redhead and John Humphreys. It's Thursday.
Testy conversations.
Well, you've been a supporter of the Labour Party all your life, Brian, so I expect you to say something like that.
Do you think we should have a one-minute silence now in this interview for you to apologise for daring to suggest that you know how I vote?
Did you threaten to overrule him?
I did not overrule Derek
Lewis. Did you threaten to overrule him?
I took advice on what I could or could not
do. Did you threaten to overrule him?
The common market embraced.
You see, yes is now showing at 67%.
Then the EU rejected.
The British people have spoken and the answer is, we're out.
We saw them come.
We'll have a new Prime Minister in that building behind me by Wednesday evening.
And go. 100 years on.
To serve the country I love.
In fact, Michelle, as I speak to you, I'm getting a call from Downing Street, so I'm going to take this call and I'll come back on to you in just a second.
Only one thing's for sure.
Chris, let's go straight back to you. You were just talking to Downing Street.
The Prime Minister has agreed to stand down.
How sad I am to be giving up the best job in the world. But them's the breaks.
Good afternoon. I have just accepted Her Majesty the Queen's kind invitation to form a new government.
After weeks of chaos and turmoil, Liz Truss calls it a day. She becomes the shortest serving Prime Minister in British history. Just 6 weeks after her appointment by Her Majesty the Queen, Liz Truss becomes a victim of her own failure to command confidence at Westminster and beyond.
No one knows what will happen next.
10 to 12 this morning, Downing Street's security gates had swung open, the motorcade swept in, heralding another new arrival here.
Here he comes, Rishi Sunak, walking up Downing Street alone to the podium to address the country for the first time as Prime Minister.
I've just been to Buckingham Palace and accepted His Majesty the King's invitation to form a government in his name.
News bulletins on TV and radio are always done live. Now, most of the time, everything goes smoothly, but just occasionally, it doesn't. One night, a group of protesters invaded the 6 o'clock news studio, and I ended up sitting on one of them.
On the air. Oh,
who is in there?
Get security.
Get security, quickly. Mix Cuso.
Good evening, the headlines at 6 o'clock.
Renee.
A vote is taking place now on a challenge to the poll tax. Tory rebels have said that the tax is unfair.
Now.
And I do apologise if you're hearing quite a lot of noise in this studio at the moment. I'm afraid that we have rather been invaded.
This is BBC World News. I'm Jonathan Charles, kept hidden for almost two decades and forced to bear children.
Two other workers are being treated after they inhaled anthrax, and tests are now starting on all 2,000 people who work at the centre. Excuse me.
He'd come to BBC Television Centre for a job interview as a computer IT assistant. Instead, Guy Gomer was mistaken for an expert on the internet music scene.
Well, Guy Cuney is the editor of the technology website News Wireless. Were you surprised by this verdict today?
I wasn't expecting that.
Now, I'm pleased to say that we should be able to return to our news studio where we rejoin Nicholas Witchell.
Well, I must apologise to you. We have had a fire here at the television centre.
Causing problems in Derbyshire, Leicestershire and the Severn Valley, where thousands of acres are underwater. Sorry about that.
Good evening. You're watching BBC News 21.
Now on BBC News 25, 4 even.
Oh dear, the lights have just gone out.
Thank you for being a friend.
Thank you for watching us every morning.
Come rain or shine.
And every evening to get the news where you are.
Don't forget us on the radio. After all, it's where BBC News first started.
A huge thank you for listening to News and Views on your local radio station.
اینجا در سرویس جهانی BBC اخبار را به 40 زبان منتشر می‌کنیم.
Thank you for trusting our impartial online reporting and analysis.
And for watching our BBC News social videos.
We broadcast right across the generations.
I won't pretend it's been easy, but we've enjoyed it, and I hope in some way that you've enjoyed it too.
What a century it has been, ever changing. The one thing that remains the same is that you, our audiences, the consumers of BBC News, are at the very heart of everything we do. So a big thank you from everyone here at BBC News.
And that's all for today from the news studio. So from me, good night.
And this bit seems to be the end.